After aminoglycosides, we have another class of antibiotics which also act on the 30S subunit of ribosomes, and they are tetracyclines. They have four cyclic rings in their structure. How they act in contrast to aminoglycosides, which used to block the initiation complex formation, tetracyclines will not let aminoacyl transfer RNA to bind to the messenger RNA ribosome complex by binding to the 30S subunit reversibly, and thus won't let the amino acid chain to grow. This will, of course, result in inhibition of protein synthesis, and thus tetracyclines are bacteriostatic in nature. Now, tetracyclines have a very broad spectrum of activity. Their activity includes that against gram-positive cocci such as Staph aureus, Strep pneumoniae, gram-negative cocci, that is gonococcus, gram-negative rods such as Vibrio cholera, H. influenza, H. pylori, and Yersinia pestis, gram-positive rods like anthrax, and some atypical bacteria such as Rickettsia, Mycoplasma, Chlamydia, and also spirochetes and actinomycetes. They can also be used in amoebiasis, leprosy, and one non-antimicrobial use is syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion. Actually, dimethylcycline is not used as an antibiotic because it has nephrotoxicity and it will block ADH receptors, so it can be used in syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion to oppose the ADH activity. To make their pharmacokinetics a bit easy to remember, we'll divide them into three groups: group 1, group 2, and group 3. Now, the group 1 will include the drugs that is tetracycline, oxytetracycline, and dimethylcycline. Group 2 will include doxycycline and minocycline, while group 3 will include tigecycline, which is actually a glycylcycline derivative. Now, for group 1, I need you to remember that these drugs should not be given with food or dairy products or mineral or calcium or vitamin supplements, because what they do is they form insoluble complexes with these ions because they have a chelating property, and thus their own absorption is also decreased, and so is the absorption of these ions. So remember to not give them with food or any of these things. Another thing to remember is that they are not metabolized except tetracycline, and they are excreted in the urine and in the bile as well. The property of chelation also causes it to be deposited in the bone, but once it is deposited in the bone, its antimicrobial property is lost, and if you're thinking that you can use it in osteomyelitis, then that's not true. For osteomyelitis, you can use clindamycin, but not this. And as I previously said, that dimethylcycline has a nephrotoxic effect and it blocks ADH activity, so it is actually not used as an antibiotic and used in syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion. After looking at the group 1 drugs, we know that we need to have some drugs that are not affected by food that much, so we have doxycycline for that. The reason behind that is the doxycycline metal complex at acidic pH in the stomach is unstable and it disintegrates and thus is absorbed in the duodenum. It can be given IV as well. Good thing about this is that we can give it in renal failure patients safely because it is excreted mainly in the bile. It is the drug of choice for rickettsial infection, Lyme disease that is caused by Borrelia burgdorferi, and also prostatitis by chlamydia because it reaches high concentration in prostatic fluid. Minocycline's absorption is also decreased by complexes. Actually, all of their absorption is decreased by complexes, and generally it's indicated to not take them with dairy products or food unless you have a stomach irritation or something like that. An important thing to remember about minocycline is that it reaches high concentration in saliva and tears. Now, if you remember from microbiology, meningococcal meningitis, that is Neisseria meningitis, it actually colonizes in the nasopharynx, and it has high it can be transmitted via saliva and tears, so we can use minocycline to eradicate the meningococcal carrier state. Lastly, the group 3 tigecycline is only administered IV, and to remember its action, we'll say that TG stands for tiger, so it can be used against MRSA and vancomycin-resistant Enterococcus faecium, and also for gram-negative aerobes. Coming to some side effects of tetracyclines, they include tooth enamel dysplasia, This is actually due to the calcium chelating property. Tetracycline calcium orthophosphate complex get deposited in the growing bone and teeth, and these teeth are actually prone to caries formation. After deposition, the teeth will appear as permanent brownish discoloration, and this discoloration will be fluorescent in UV light. There is decreased bone growth in children due to the same reasons. They are also associated with phototoxicity, especially domiclocycline and doxycycline, and they manifest as sunburn-like rashes and also pigmentation of nails. They can cause GI distress, that is nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, and also superinfection, because as they are incompletely absorbed from the gut flora is disturbed and leading to superinfection, of course, by C. difficile and also by Candida and Proteus, etc. They also cause hepatic toxicity, and especially in pregnancy, this toxicity is increased, leading to acute hepatic necrosis and fatty changes. And as I also already said, it is renally toxic, and domiclocycline has ADH opposing property, so it will cause nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. So we use this property in syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion for the third time. Okay, so next, it can also cause Fanconi syndrome, that is a rare disorder having many causes, one of which is the use of outdated tetracyclines, causing polyuria, proteinuria, and acidosis. It can also cause pseudotumor cerebri. Now, this is not a tumor, pseudotumor, so it causes increased intracranial pressure around the brain, and it can lead to many symptoms. There are many causes, and one drug-related cause is tetracyclines use. There can be hypersensitivity reactions, cross-sensitivity is also common, and minocycline has been reported to cause vestibular dysfunction. Now, as we can see that there is tooth enamel dysplasia, decreased bone growth in children, and hepatic toxicity, especially in pregnancy, that makes it all the tetracyclines contraindicated in pregnancy and also in children less than 8 years of age. Lastly, the two modes of resistance for tetracyclines, one is efflux pumps. What the bacteria do is they sort of pump out the drug, tetracyclines, out of the cell, and this sort of resistance is not specific for tetracycline. It causes multi-drug resistance because these pumps are not specified for tetracyclines only. They are specified for any foreign substance. Secondly, they can also face resistance by inactivation by bacterial enzymes.